وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. We were in the introduction of the biography and the life of Al-Imam Abu Dawood rahimahullah. We spoke about Siratul Imam Abi Dawood al-Shakhsiyah. We spoke about his personal life, where he was born, his upbringing. We also spoke about his lineage, his children, and the fact that he was married. We now were in the middle of speaking of Al-Imam, Hayat Al-Imam Abi Dawood Al-Ilmiyah, which was the second point. We were speaking about Al-Imam Abi Dawood Rahimahullah, his biography, like from the angle of his knowledge. And that's what we were speaking about yesterday. I stopped at speaking of Al-Imam Abi Dawood's mu'allafat, the books that he authored, and the works that he has put together, rahimahullah. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, rahimahullah, he wrote many books in the science of hadith, ilm al-rijal, fiqh, aqidah, tafsir. Some of his books have reached us, and some of his books haven't reached us. We haven't seen it. So inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to divide the books of Al-Imam Abi Dawood into two. Books which are matbu'a mutadawala, books that are published, and that we have, and that we've seen. And the second one is books that are mafquda, that are missing, or as we think, will not be found. Inshallah ta'ala, hoping that Allah will bring it to light, and it will be seen, inshallah ta'ala. So those are the two I'm going to divide his works into. And Imam Abi Dawood, the books that he wrote that are published, from them, number one is the Sunan. This book that we have, Sunani Abi Dawood. His Sunan is matbu' and is mutadawal. It is published and it's seen. And we're going to speak about that in more details, inshallah ta'ala. And the methodology of the author and matters pertaining to that, we'll speak about that in more details, inshallah ta'ala. The second authorship, or the second book that he has authored, which is matbu' mutadawal, is Risalatuhu ila Ahli Makkah. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, when he wrote his Sunan, he actually wrote a letter or a little risala where he describes his book, his Sunan. He describes it and he speaks about it. And the best taba'a for his risala ila Ahli Makkah is the taba'a by Muhammad al-Sabbagh, rahimahullah. That's the best publication. And I think, if I'm not wrong, it is the taba'a Darul Ta'seel used for the Sunan Abi Dawood. It's the taba'a by Muhammad al-Sabbagh rahimahullah. If you guys can switch this off, it makes a lot of noise. And inshallah ta'ala, for that 1 hour, the heat should not be a problem, inshallah, sah? Yeah, ikhwah, shouldn't be a problem. Ah. So the third book that Imam Abi Dawood rahimahullah he wrote is Al-Marasil. Imam Abi Dawood has a Marasil, which is a kutub, a kitab mukhassas li jami'i ahadith al-marasil. He brought all the ahadith which are mursal. Mursal is what? Ma asnadahu tabi'iyun ila rasulillah. A mursal is what? A mursal is that which a tabi'i attributes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. All of the ahadith which are mursal, Al-Imam Abi Dawood rahimahullah, he brought it into this book. And what's good about it is, رَتَّبَهُ عَلَىٰ أَبْوَابِ الْفِقِيَّةِ. The way he organized it is in a fiqh chapterings. That's what the way he did it, rahimahullah. And he brings all of the chapters under it, all the ahadith which are marasil. And so it's a good book. And the number of ahadiths that he brought in there is 537 hadiths. 537 hadith in total is what he had bought. The best taba'ah out there is the taba'ah by Dr. Abdullah ibn Masa'id al-Zahrani, rahimahullah. That's the best taba'ah that is published right now. And in Matubi'a Mirar, and many people published it, but this is the best. The fourth one is Masa'il al-Imam Ahmad. And Imam Abi Dawood wrote a kitab called Masa'il al-Imam Ahmad. And this book is in the chapter of fiqh. It's in the chapter of what? It's in fiqh. And the book again is organized and it's placed according to what? Ala abwab al-fiqh, in chapters of fiqh, the way he put it together. And the tahqiq that's out there is the tahqiq of Muhammad Rida. And then many times after that it got published. The fifth one is Su'alati Abi Dawood al-Imam Ahmad fil Rijal. This book is Su'alati Abi Dawood. Abi Dawood asking questions to Imam al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah, and he's asking him about men and the narrators and individuals. And then Imam Ahmad gives him response and he writes it down. And this has been published by the Taba'a, which is the best right now, is the Taba'a of Ziyad Muhammad al-Mansur. His Taba'a is the best. So it's published and it's out there. Number six is Arwatu min al-Ikhwati wal-Akhawat. Narrators who are brothers and sisters. That's well spoken about in Mustalah al-Hadith. He has a kitab in this and it's written. And I don't know which publication is the best. But I know Basim al-Jawabirah, Hafidhahullah, who is Hay. I know he has a tahqiq on the kitab, and that's the one I have. Su'alat Abi Ubaidah is another kitab that he wrote, which is Su'alat Abi Dawood, Abu Ubaidah al-Ajurri. We're going to speak about him later. Abu Ubaidah al-Ajurri, asking questions to who? Abi Dawood. And then Imam Abi Dawood's responding to it in Jarh al-Ta'dil. And it's been published many times. And the publication I have is the Tahqiq of Muhammad Ali al-Imrani, which is published. Also Jam' Islamiyya, Medina al-Munawwara, the University of Medina, they published it. The eighth book is Az-Zuhd, a book in aestheticism. And Imam Abi Dawood rahimahullah wrote it. It's called Az-Zuhd. And the tahqiq that's out there is Al-Diyya al-Hasan al-Salafi rahimahullah. He also done the tahqiq of the kitab. And then another tahqiq came out, and another tahqiq came out, and many. But I have the first one. All of those books that I mentioned are books which are matbu'. And Imam Abi Dawood wrote these books and they are published. Or it's books like Su'alat Abi Ubaidah al-Ajurriyu is a question that he's been asked to Imam Abi Dawood. But Al-Imam Abi Dawood didn't write it, of course, but it's questions that have been asked to him. So it's a book that's going to be attributed to who? To him, because it's the knowledge of Al-Imam Abi Dawood, rahimahullah. Now we're going to go into the books which are lost, that we don't have. They are kutub which are al-mafquda, books that he wrote, but then we don't have them. It got lost. The first one is Al-Nasikh wal-Mansukh. Al-Imam Abi Dawood has a kitab on Nasikh wal-Mansukh. And it was narrated by him, by Abu Bakr al-Najjad, is the one who narrated it from him. This kitab is actually mafqud. There's no way to find it. Ibn al-Khayr al-Ishbiliyu in his Fihrasat, he mentions that the name is Nasikh al-Qur'an wa Mansukhi. The Nasikh of the Qur'an and the Mansukh of the Qur'an. The verses which are abrogated and the verses that are abrogating, and Imam Abi Dawood wrote of it. The second book that he wrote is a kitab called Ar-Raddu ala Ahli al-Qadr, Refutation on the People of Qadr. Al-Imam Abi Dawood wrote this kitab. It's mafqud, which some scholars, they call it Ar-Raddu ala Ahli al-Ahwa'i wal-Qadr, the refutation of the people of desires and the people of Qadr. Many scholars have transmitted from it. ولذلك Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi rahimahullah, he brings some riwayat from there and he does with the rumuz. Meaning, the Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi, in his Tuhfatul Ashraf, or his Tahdhib al Kamal, what he does is sometimes when he transmits from books, he doesn't mention the names, the person's full name, he would use symbols, okay, of that book. It's a rams that he would use. So he transmits from that book sometimes, and the rams that he uses is qad, meaning qadariya. Shufa qadariya, he just used qaf and dal. So even that we haven't seen it, but Imam Abu al-Hajjaj al-Miziyu saw the book, and he narrated from it. So anyone who ever transmits something from that kitab, they'll always do it through a wasita, through a means. Not directly from the kitab itself, because the kitab itself is what? It's mafqood. He also, Ibn Battah in Kitab al-Ibana, he also transmits from him. Also from the books that he also published is Al-Ba'th wa-Nushur, the resurrection. He wrote a kitab in that, and it's kitab which is mafqood. Another kitab is Dala'il al-Nubuwa. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a prophecy. Nowadays, Dala'il al-Nubuwa is called what? Mu'jizat is called. Mu'jiza, the Salaf never used to use that term. The word mu'jiza is not a term that the Salaf of Hadhi al-Ummah would use. They would use Dala'il al-Nubuwa. Dala'il al-Nubuwa means the sign of his prophecy. Whatever is the Prophet's sign of prophecy is called Dala'il al-Nubuwa. He wrote a kitab in this. He also wrote a kitab called At-Tafarrud fi Deen. And this is what he means. What he means by this is, as Imam al-Hajjaj al-Miziyu mentioned, ما تفرد به أهل الأمصار من السنن. His sunan that he wrote, those who went against him and wrote other books, what are they alone in that are not in his sunan? He wrote a kitab on that. He also has Musnad Malik. He has a kitab number 6, it's called Musnad Malik. And Imam Malik's Musnad, the narrations of Imam Malik, he brings it in there. He also has another kitab, Fada'il al-Ansar, the virtues of the people of Ansar. It's mafqood. He has a kitab called Al-Muwaqit, which Al-Imam al-Miziyu called it Ma'rifatul Awqat, knowing the times of the prayer. Number 6, he has a kitab called At-Taharatul Kabir, where he talks about the purity. He has a kitab called Fada'il Ramadan, the virtues of Ramadan, wa sittin min Shawwal, and the 6 days of Shawwal, wal ashr wa ashura. All one book. He talks about the virtue of all of that. That book is mafqood. We don't have that book. He has a kitab called Manasik al-Hajj al-Kabir. Hajj, and how to do the ritual of Hajj. He wrote a book in this, and it's also mafqood. He has a book called Al-Qadha al-Kabir, where he speaks about Al-Qadha wal-Qadr. Well, some scholars, they said he spoke about in that book, Ahkam pertaining to Qadha, judgment. And what's the difference between Al-Fatwa and Qadha, to judge between people. He also wrote another kitab called Al-Iman Qawlun Wa Amal. Iman is speech and its actions. He wrote a kitab called A'lam al-Nubuwa, Al-Imam Abi Dawood Rahimahullah. And last book, which is mafqood, the kitab A'lam al-Nubuwa, the one I just mentioned, is this, again, it's close to Dala'il al-Nubuwa. He talks about the signs of the Prophet when he's coming out as a prophet. The last one, which is the 15th one, is called Al-Mubtada. So you might think it's Mubtada, which is grammar. No, it's not. He speaks about from the birth of Nabiullah Musa until the people of Musa made it through the sea and Fir'aun. And he also speaks in there the seerah of our Prophet ﷺ. So from Nabiullah Musa's time to Nabiullah Muhammad's time. He starts and he speaks about that. Here we've spoken about the books that Imam Abi Dawood has written. We've spoken about what? Inta magali kala. Magali kala samana. So now we've spoken about and we've discussed. The books that Imam Abi Dawood wrote, we categorize them into how many? Kutub which were matbu'a, books that are published, and kutub which are mafquda, that we don't have. Now we're going to go into makanatuhu al-ilmiyah, the station of knowledge that Imam Abi Dawood held. How was he lacking his knowledge, Imam Abi Dawood? Imam Abi Dawood, he is one of the most famous scholars in hadith. A lot of us here already know who Imam Abi Dawood is. He's min al-mubarrazin, those who became famous and well known, rahimahullah. But what was he known for? He was known for riwaya, narrations. And he's also known for riwaya and diraya. He was well known for the fiqh of the hadith and the chain of the hadith. He was an alim, not just in the chain of narration. La abadan. He, rahimahullah, was well known for the fiqh as well. And as I said to you before, from the six books of hadith, Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i, six. The only two who were mujtahid mutlaq was Bukhari and who? Abi Dawood only. They were the only two which were mujtahid mutlaq. Muslim wasn't mujtahid mutlaq. And Imam Tirmidhi wasn't. Ibn Majah wasn't. And Nasa'i wasn't. They were the followers of a particular madhab, and that was madhab al-hadith. They used to restrict themselves within the madhab al-hadith. Like Imam Abi Dawood and Imam al-Bukhari, both of them would look at the textual evidence and they would extract rulings from it. As Imam Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah mentions in his Majmu' al-Fatawa. Imam Abi Dawood, there were factors that helped him become who he became, that supported him. Number one, brothers, is himma aliyah fi al-talab. He had high aspirations. And Imam Abi Dawood had high aspirations. If a person doesn't want to attain something, then there's no one who can make them attain it. If you don't have the drive within you, then you're never going to reach it. It has to be something from you. It has to be that drive and that desire burning in you that makes you go out of your way wanting to learn. He had that, rahimahullah, himma aliyah fi al-talab, in seeking knowledge. Also was, he benefited from marhalatu shabab. He benefited from the time he was young. It's very important. Some people, they wake up, they realize everything at a time when it's what? A time when it's long gone. A time when it's what? When it's long gone and he's missed the opportunity of being a shab. Yeah? Mali idha jadabtuha sa'aytu. أكبر علاني أم بيت ليت الشباب وهل ينفع شيئا ليت ليت الشباب انبوع فاشتريت. The poet, he realized late, after he's become old, he can't pick up what he used to pick up when he was young. The free time that he had, all of it is gone. He's now realized it. He says, مالي إذا جذبتها صعيت. Why is it that when I pull the rope from the well, I make noise? I'm going, ah, I feel the pain. Why is it? Is it A, what is it that's on me, that's pushing me down? And he goes, later, if only, وَهَلْ يَنْفَعُ شَيْئًا لَيْتُ. Only, but will that benefit him? And then he goes, later, لَيْتَ الشَّبَابًا بُعَ فَاشْتَرَيْتُ. I wish that youth was something that could be bought and sold from the market. I wish it could be. But no, it's not. So Imam Abi Dawood realized that he was young and that he was a shab. And so he benefited from that opportunity. Also, Imam Abi Dawood, the factor that supported and helped him was his nafs was very pure. He was a very pure individual. Tahir. Halal. He ate halal. Rahimahullah. These are factors that help the person. That if you live with halal income, Allah will open doors for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, Imam Abi Dawood had a nafs that hated al-dhuhur wa hubb al-shuhra. He didn't like fame or to be known or to be out. He didn't. He really loved to be unknown. These are things that will help. He didn't like al-riya and sum'a. He didn't like al-riya. Al-riya is what? People to see him. And al-sum'a is that people hear of him. He didn't like that. Also, what Imam Abi Dawood had was al-tafarrugh al-tami lil-ilm wa tahsilihi. He had time that he spent in seeking knowledge, full time. Where Imam Abi Dawood would do nothing other than seek knowledge. That's what knowledge likes. Knowledge, if you want to attain it, it requires and it wants from you at-tafarrugh at-tam, that you free yourself fully from knowledge. It doesn't accept associating partners with it. Knowledge does not like shirk. It likes tawheed, meaning it likes for you to do it alone. It doesn't want you to associate partners with it. It doesn't like you having a job on this. It doesn't like that. It wants it alone. ولذلك, if you give knowledge everything, it will give you something in return. That's when you give it everything and you exert everything, it will give you what? It will give you something in return. So this is what he did. Also what he did, rahimahullah, is وَرِحْلَةٌ لَمْ تَنْقَطْعِ إِلَّا بِحُلُولِ الْأَجَلِ. رِحْلَة, he travelled. This travelling of his did not stop until death came to him. Wherever he heard there was knowledge, he would go. And also what helped him was عَصْرٌ حَضَارِيٌ يَسْمَحُ لِأَمْثَالِ بِالتَّفَوُّقِ وَالْبُرُوزِ. He was at a time, and he lived at a time and an era where people were all about seeking knowledge. If somebody passed you, it was because of knowledge. But we don't live at a time like that today. We're living at a time today that if a person opens a YouTube account, خلاص, he's min alam al alam, he's mufti. Sahih? يُشَارُ إِلَيْهِ بِالْبَنَانِ. That's it, خلاص. Like, in the truth of the matter is, at that time, you would not be given the mashiyakha. You would not be allowed to teach unless you had what? Unless you had real knowledge. Unless you had comprehension of the deen. And hifz. Then you would go forward. Or else you would sit back. This story is going to give us an understanding of makanatuhu al-ilmiyya. The station of al-imam Abi Dawood in knowledge. This story is going to tell us it. This story is a story that I touched on it yesterday, but it's mentioned by Imam al-Khattabi in his Kitab Ma'alim al-Sunan. He says, عن أبي بكر بن جابر خادم أبي داود. Imam Abi Dawood, as we mentioned yesterday, what did he have? He had a maid. Imam Abi Dawood had a maid. So Imam al-Khattabi said, and the maid was called Abi Bakr ibn Jabir. He said, كُنْتُمْ مَعَهُ بِبَغْدَادِ. The slave, the maid, he said, I was with Al-Imam Abi Dawood, I was with him, in Baghdad. فَصَلَّيْنَا الْمَغْرِبَ. We prayed Salatul al-Maghrib. We prayed what? Salatul al-Maghrib. إِذَا قُرِعَ الْبَابُ فَفَتَحْتُهُ. The door got knocked. And then Abu Bakr ibn Jabirin, who is the maid, he said, I stood up and I went to open the door. When I opened the door, it was the leader, the Khalifa came. So Al-Imam Abi Dawood rahimahullah, he said, I went Al-Imam Abi Dawood, where is he? So the maid said to him, wait. So he went to Al-Imam Abi Dawood and he told him that the Amir is what? The Amir is outside waiting. So Al-Imam Abi Dawood said, let him in. And then Al-Imam Abi Dawood said to the Amir, مَا جَاءَ الْأَمِيرُ. What is it? مَا جَاءَ بِالْأَمِيرِ فِي مِثْلَ هَذِي الْوَقْتِ. What is it that brought the Amir at this particular time? And then he said, the Amir responded to Al-Imam Abi Dawood and he said to him, خِلَالٌ ثَلَاث. Three things. Three reasons and three things are what brought the Amir. And then he said to him, وَمَا هِيَ. And Imam Abi Dawood said, what is it? He said, number one, تَنْتَقِلُ إِلَى الْبَصَرَةِ. You're going to go to Basra. فَتَتَّخِذُهَا وَطَنًا. And you're going to make it a place of residency. لِيَرْحَلَ إِلَيْكَ طَلَبَةُ الْعِلْمِ. So the people of knowledge can travel to you مِنْ أَقْطَارِ الْأَرْضِ, from all of the lands. فَتَعْمُرَ بِكَ. And through you, after Allah, Basra can now become a place where the population increases and the people come back to it. They flock back to Basra. فَإِنَّهَا قَدْ خَرِبَتْ. Basra has now become destroyed. And it's become what? The infrastructure and everything has gone. And this was where? This was the land of civilization for the Muslims. All of it has gone. So he wants Al-Imam Abi Dawood to go there, and so the students of knowledge are going to flock from all over the world and come to him to seek hadith from him. وَانْقَطَ عَنْهَا النَّاسِ. The people have now boycotted Basra. لِمَا جَرَى عَلَيْهَا مِنْ مِحْنَةِ الزُّنْجِ. Because of the fitna that happened due to the fitna to zunj, ama zinj, some other scholars call it, this fitna has taken place here. Al-Imam, so what's this fitna? This fitna, I'm going to narrate it from the Muruj al-Dhahab by Al-Mas'udi. He mentions that the fitna to a zunj, I'm going to come to it later, inshallah ta'ala, the fitna, in more details. So Al-Imam Abi Dawood said, فَهَذِهِ وَاحِدَةً. Okay, this is the first request. Meaning I've accepted the first request to move to Basra. هَاتِ الثَّانِيَةً. Give me the second reason why you came to me. He said, تَرْوِي لِأَوْلَادِ كِتَابَ السُّنَنْ. You're going to narrate to my children your sunan. You're going to give them the chance to hear the sunan from your mouth. فَقَالَ نَعَمْ. And Imam Abi Dawood said, okay. هَاتِ الثَّالِثَةً. Give me the third thing that you want. He said, the third request is, وَتُفْرِدُ لَهُمْ مَجْلِسًا لِلْرِوَايَةِ. You're going to specify for them a sit in a majlis where only they're going to hear it from you. No one else is allowed to come and participate. Meaning Abi Dawood and the leader's children is going to be this gathering. So they can hear it from you uniquely. No one else is going to be there. Why? فَإِنَّ أَوْلَادَ الْخُلَفَاءِ. Because the children's leader, the leader of the children, لَا يَقْعَدُونَ مَعَ الْعَامَةِ. They're not going to sit with the general mass. The Khalifa's children, they're not going to sit with the general mass. And then Al-Imam Abi Dawood said, أَمَّا هَذِي. As for the third request, فَلَا سَبِيلَ إِلَيْهَا. There's no way to this one. There's no way to attain it. لِأَنَّ النَّاسَ شَرِيفَهُمْ. Because the people, the most honorable from amongst them, وَوَضِيعَهُمْ. And the lowest of them, فِي الْعِلْمِ سَوَاءَ. They are equal in knowledge. There's no one who has superiority and has the upper hand over anyone when it comes to knowledge. Abu Bakr ibn Jabirin, the khadim of Imam Abi Dawood, he said, فَكَانُوا بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ يَحْضُرُونَ وَيَقْعَدُونَ فِي كَمٍ حَرِيٍ. From that day onwards, the children of the leader, they used to come and they used to sit because they wanted the sunan. وَيُضْرَبُ بَيْنَهُمْ وَبَيْنَ النَّاسِ سِتْرٌ. They would sit and a curtain would be placed between them and the people. فَيَسْمَعُونَ مَعَ الْعَامَةِ. And then they would listen with the people. The Amir requested from who? Al-Imam Abi Dawood here. تَنْتَقِلُ إِلَى الْبَصَرَةِ. You're going to go to Basra. فَتَتَّخِذُهَا وَطَنًا. And you're going to make it a place that you're going to stay. Pay attention. That was the second request, right? The second request was what? The first request. It was the first, huh? That you're going to go to what? Basra. And you're going to take that a place of residence. You're going to live there, and the people are going to flock to you. This, brothers, as Al-Imam al-Dhahabi mentioned, he said, دَلَالَ وَاضِحًا. This is a clear-cut indication. عَلَىٰ أَنَّ أَبَا دَاوُودْ قَدْ بَلَغَ الذِّرْوَةَ الْعُلْيَا فِي الْمَكَانَةِ. This shows that Al-Imam Abi Dawood, he reached the pinnacle. That a whole city became corrupt, and he can build it if he goes back by himself. And this is something that we need to take into consideration. Which is, brothers, when fitna happen, the solution for it is ilm. It's not investing money into that land and building skyscrapers. And it's not bringing actresses and artists and etc. No. If a place wants to be shunned and lit, what should be brought to the people is what? العلم النافع, beneficial knowledge. The leader understood that. That the people could be taken out of the fitna and everything that had happened with what, brothers? The sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is an important point that we need to take into consideration and understand this. And that a lot of scholars were like this. Abu Dawood was not the only one. Al-Imam Ma'mar ibn Rashid, the people of Yemen, how did he end up staying with them? When he went and he visited Yemen, and they saw his knowledge, and they saw his mind and his ability, they married him off to the women of Yemen to keep him in Yemen. Rahimahullah. To keep him in Yemen so he can narrate and he can tell the narrations of the Prophet ﷺ, because they believed they needed him. And he resided and he stayed in Yemen. Rahimahullah. Many of the scholars were like that. If a place became destroyed, their way to bring people back is, ya ikhwa, with what? Ilmun nafi'. And Imam Abi Dawood Abraza, he became very famous and well known and grounded in ilmul hadith, ilmul fiqh, hadith, riwayat and wa diraya, rahimahullah, jarh wa ta'deel, ilal, and etc. The things that he became famous for were all of them. So we're going to stand over one after the other. Number one, an Imam Abi Dawood was an Imam in what? The narrations in which he heard and he memorized. He had memorized and he learnt a lot. ولذلك الإمام أبي داود, what did he say? كتبت عن رسول الله, I wrote from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, meaning the ahadith of the Prophet that I have with me. He said is 500,000 hadith, 500,000 hadith I have. Where does he have it? In his brain. He's memorized it, rahimahullah. These are the narrations, ahadith I have. He said, I wrote all of these hadiths. And he then says, انتخبتُ منها ما تضم ضمنته هذا الكتاب. He said, I wrote 500,000 ahadiths. انتخبتُ منها, I chose from those 500. ما ضمنته, that which I placed inside هذا الكتاب, يعني كتاب السنن. From the 500,000, I selected and I chose a hadith that I placed inside my sunan. I didn't place all of it. And it was said that an Imam Abi Dawood, every single day, he will sit down and he will do mudhakara, revision of 100,000 ahadiths daily. He would revise. And every 5 days, he would finish the 500,000 ahadiths that he wanted to revise. This is not the Quran. These are the what? We're struggling with memorizing 40 hadith of Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah, sah? 40? Two hadiths, huh? That's all it is. And if somebody memorizes the 42 and adds the 8 of Ziyadat ibn Rajab, Ziyadat al-Rajabiyyah, and makes it how many? 50 today in London is what? Mufti, sah? Of East London. Sah, ya ikhwa? He's the Mufti of East London, if a person memorizes it. Pay attention, this is very important. So this shows the knowledge of an Imam Abi Dawood when it came to hadith and what he had. Also, ilm al-jarh wa ta'deel. An Imam Abi Dawood, he was strong and he was grounded in what? The ilm of what? Ilm of jarh wa ta'deel. This ilm, ya ikhwa, ilm al-jarh wa ta'deel, min as'ab ulum al-hadith. Jarh wa ta'deel, brothers, is the hardest field of hadith. It's the hardest subject in hadith. فَلَا يُقَدَّمُ إِلَيْهِ. No one comes forward towards it and goes towards its direction إِلَّا مَنِ اتَّصَفَ, except a person whose characteristics is سِعَةِ الْإِطِّلَاعِ. He's known to read a lot. A person who has read, has looked at narrations, has seen things, this is the person who goes forward to it. He's looked at the أَخْبَارَ الْمَرْوِيَّةِ, the narrations that have been transmitted, he has read it. These are the characteristics of a person who can speak about this issue. من كان عارفا بأحوال أولئك الرواة وطرق مروياتهم وبالأسباب الداعية إلى التساهل أو الانحراف عند بعضهم إضافة إلى معلومات حديثية أخرى كمعرفة السنة ولادة الراوي ووفاته وممن سمع ومن أخذ عنه وكيف كانت كتبه هل هي صحيحة أم لا إلى غير ذلك مما لا بد منه في هذا الميدان. The narrators, when were they born? When did they die? Who did they meet? When did they meet them? What city they met them in? He has to know all of that. He also has to know what are criticism that can be placed on a person and what criticism is weak. How to prioritize when a criticism is given precedence over a praise. All of these are sciences that a person who has deep knowledge can speak about. And Imam Abi Dawood was what? He was min ha'ula'i al-afdad. He was from those scholars who was allowed to speak about this field. This is a field, ya ikhwa, hatta al-imam Shafi'i kan la yatatarraqu ilayh. And Imam Shafi'i never speak about this. Muhammad ibn Idris, al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, never used to speak about it. And now we have people who would speak about this issue who will struggle to read Fatiha. Sahih? They will do al-jarh wa ta'deel. And they'll say, Fulan, Alan, Sahih. And they can't read Surah. They say, Walallah, Lin, except other than Dadad. And these Masail that Al Imam Shafi'i, he would do tawakuf of. And he would ask who? Ahmed ibn Hanbal. And he would say, Ahmed, what do you say in this regard? The person who have Jur'ah to go forward in it. Al-Imam Abi Dawood was what? For أحد أئمة الجرح والتعديل. He's from the A'immas of جرح والتعديل. And he was from the shuyukh of this field. He was of the Rome, and he was in the line and in the group of Al-Imam Ahmed rahimahullah in this field. He was with Yahya ibn Ma'in in this field, and Ali ibn al-Madini, and Imam al-Bukhari, and the likes of them. And Ibn Abi Hatim, and Abi Zur'a, Abi Dawood was in there when it came to this field, rahimahullah. He's from those people, mimman makkanahu Allahu tabahhur. Allah gave him tabahhur, meaning he was deep into this field. If you buy the kitab that I mentioned before, su'alati Abu Ubaidah al-Ajurri rahimahullah to al-Imam Abi Dawood in Jarh al-Ta'dil, you read that kitab and you look at it, you'll be amazed of how he knows it. Also, the third thing that Imam Abi Dawood that shows his knowledge is ilmu ilal al-hadith. The knowledge of what? Ilal of a hadith. Ilal al-hadith, ya ikhwa, is from the sciences which are very what? Very complicated. Because the science of ilal al-hadith is something to do with ghumud. It's very hidden. Ilal al-hadith, for example, would be a person who comes and narrates from an imam every time. He's always narrating from this imam. But that particular day when the imam was narrating that hadith, that particular person wasn't there. Scholars of hadith would have to know if he was there or not. This is illah. They would pick this up. With qara'in, external factors, they will look into and they will pick that up. And one of the best books that are contemporary written, and I really find it very beneficial, and I advise if you guys can read it, is written by Sheikh Tariq Iwadullahi. Sheikh Tariq Iwadullahi. He's alive. Hayyun Yurzak. He's from Egypt. And now he resides in. Now he resides in America. He's in Minnesota. He wrote a kitab called Al-Irshad. This kitab, from the people who are the Mu'asirin today who are alive, he's, mashallah, he done a very good job. This kitab, when he speaks about ilal hadith and taqwiyatul shawahid, strengthening hadith based on shawahid, this kitab, a person should try to buy it and look into it. There's another sheikh who is from Iraq, who's alive today. His name's called Mahir Yasin al-Fahl. Mahir Yasin al-Fahl. He's from the students of Bashar Awad Ma'ruf. He has a kitab called Al-Ilal. And I think it's 5 or 6 volumes. Faisal, do you know how many volumes it is? Dar ibn al-Jawzi done the taba'a of it. This book teaches you how to study this Ilal. So this science is very complicated, Ilal. When I went to India, I was with a sheikh, Indian scholar, who graduated from Jami' Islamiyah, who did the tahqiq of the kitab Al-Ilal al-Warida, by Al-Imam Ad-Darqutni rahimahullah. He done his PhD on that kitab. He was working on that book, Al-Ilal al-Warida, by Al-Imam Ad-Darqutni. ولذلك Al-Ilal al-Warida by Ad-Darqutni is the best. Every single person who came after took it from him. Are we all together? Al-Ilal al-Warida, everyone who came took it from him, Al-Imam Ad-Darqutni rahimahullah. And the Sheikh, he done a tahqiq on a portion of it, not all of it, but a portion of it. He done tahqiq of it. His name is Sheikh Ubaidur Rahman ibn Muhammad ibn Hanif al-Madani, hafidhahullah ta'ala. And it's funny because the Dara Qutniyu Kitab Ilal al-Warida, which is nearly 30 volumes. He read it all from his memory. He never looked at it anyway. It was just read. He read it, and the people were writing it from him. It shows these people's memory and their brain and their work and their efforts. Rahimahumullah jami'an. So the people he references a lot in that book is who? Abu Dawood, rahimahullah. The Abu Dawood is from the a'imma of this field. When looking for hidden defects of a hadith, وَلِذَٰلِكَ the scholars, they praised him for this. Al-Imam ibn Manda, rahimahullah, he said, أَلَّذِينَ أَخْرَجُوا الصَّحِيحَ وَمَيَّزُوا الثَّابِتَ مِنَ الْمَعْلُولِ وَالْخَطَأِ مِنَ الصَّوَابِ أَرْبَعَ. Four people are the ones who have brought a hadith which are authentic. They also distinguish from the ahadith which have hidden defects from the ahadith which are authentic. They've distinguished one from the other. Are four people. Four scholars were known for this. Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood al-Sijistani, and Al-Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah. You can say Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, or you can say Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, however you say. Or you can even say Al-Imam al-Nasawi. Three ways you can say his name. Al-Imam, all these are the four he said. They're well known for what? وَمَيَّزُ الثَّابِتَ مِنَ الْمَعْلُولِ. They distinguish the ahadith which are authentic from the hadith that have hidden defect. Abu Dawood was very good at that. He was with Al-Bukhari and he was with Muslim in this field, and also he's with Al-Imam al-Nasa'i as well. وَلِذَلِكَ if you read Sunan al-Nasa'i and inshallah Sunan Abi Dawood, we're going to see a lot of ilal in it that we have to pick up, that we have to know inshallah ta'ala. Fourth thing that Al-Imam Abi Dawood was good at is fiqh al-hadith. That's the reason why we chose this book. This book has fiqh. He picked the best wordings for each chapter. This can only come from a person who has what? Strong fiqh. He selected, rahimahullah, and he handpicked, and he chose, what did he choose? The ahadith based on the wording, because he wanted to extract fiqh from it, rahimahullah. In this regard, as I said before, he's qareenul Imam al-Bukhari. He's like al-Imam al-Bukhari. Because Bukhari, in his sahih, he didn't place a hadith except he prayed what? Yeah? He prayed what? Two rak'ah. So based on al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, al-Imam al-Bukhari prayed 14,000 rak'ah to place his sunan, his sahih. So every hadith, as some of the riwayat mentioned, every chapter. So if it's every single hadith, he prayed two rak'ah, he prayed 14,000 taqriban rak'ah al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, just for his sahih. Are we all together, brothers? That's just the sahih. Forget the other sunnahs that he used to pray and anything else. Rahimahullah. So al-Imam al-Bukhari used to choose, and he used to do istikhara, and he used to pray for a hadith that he would place in his sahih. He would choose it. It wasn't just throw the hadith in there. It was chosen, it was picked. Whereas Al-Imam Abi Dawood was the same. He picked and he chose. وَلِذَٰلِكَ the scholars, they say, anyone who memorizes Sunan Abi Dawood, memorizes it, and he understands it, this person is strong in fiqh. Understands Sunan Abi Dawood. And he memorizes Sunan Abi Dawood because it's the greatest book in Ahadith al-Ahkam. It's the strongest book in Ahadith al-Ahkam. It's not the biggest, but it's the strongest. The biggest is Sunan al-Kubra, al-Imam al-Bayhaqi, rahimahullah. That's the biggest book in Ahadith al-Ahkam. What does Ahadith al-Ahkam mean? Ahadith al-Ahkam means ahadith that are pertaining to jurisprudent rulings, fiqh-related matters. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ are different. Some ahadith are heart-softening, some are virtuous actions, and etc. Sunan Abi Dawood is not like that. Sunan Abi Dawood doesn't talk about virtues and righteous deeds. No, it talks about ahkam rulings. Sahih? That's why it's called Sunan. Sunan here means fiqhiyat is going to speak about. So Imam Abi Dawood was strong in this particular field, rahimahullah ta'ala. Here's the question that was asked to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Al-Imam ibn Taymiyyah was asked, هل البخاري ومسلم وابي داود والترمذي والنسائي وابن ماجه هل كان هؤلاء مجتهدين لم يقلدوا احدا من الائمه ام كانوا مقلدين؟ Was Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim and Abi Dawood and Tirmidhi and Nasa'i and Ibn Majah, were they muqallideen or were they mujtahideen? Who was asked this question? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Look what he said, Ibn Taymiyyah. He said, أَمَّا الْبُخَارِيُّ وَأَبِي دَاوُودِ. As for Bukhari and Abi Dawood, فَإِمَامَانِ فِي الْفِقْهِ. Both of them are imams in fiqh. مِنْ أَهْلِ الْإِجْتِهَادِ. They are from the scholars of ijtihad. وَأَمَّا مُسْلِمْ وَالْتِرْمِذِي وَالنَّسَائِي وَابْنُ مَاجَةِ. And he mentioned others. فَهُمْ عَلَى مَذْهَبِ أَهْلِ الْحَدِيثِ. They are upon the madhab of Ahl al-Hadith. They are upon a madhab called madhabu Ahl al-Hadith. Meaning, they will look at the kalam of Al-Awza'i and Layth ibn Sa'ad and Malik and Shafi'i and others. And whatever was correct and the evidence was leaning towards, they would take them. This is madhab Ahl al-Hadith. Meaning, because some people, when they wrote Tabaqatu Shafi'iyya, they added Imam Muslim to it. And they said, Imam Muslim is a Shafi'i. And the Hanabila, in the Tabaqatu al-Hanabila, they added Muslim to it and they said he's a Hanbali. Where did the problem come from? Because they saw times that Imam Muslim was agreeing with Imam Ahmad, so they thought he was a Hanbali. Or they saw him agree with Shafi'i, then they thought he was a Shafi'i. No, he's not. He follows wherever the haq is with. Are we together, brothers? لكن الإمام البخاري and الإمام أبي داود, don't look at who said this. They are a'imma, mujtahideen. They just look at the dalil and they extract the rulings out of it. They look at the nusus and they extract from it. Whereas the others will look at what did Layth ibn Sa'ad say? What did Awza'i say? What did Sufyan al-Thawri say in this issue? What did Uyayna say, Sufyan ibn Uyayna? What did Ma'mar say? What did Malik say? And when they look at each one, what's the evidence for Malik? What is the evidence for Shafi'i? What is the evidence of Fulan? And when they saw everyone's evidence, and Ahmed, when they saw everyone's evidence, whoever they thought was closest to the truth, they would take. This is madhab Ahli, madhab Ahli Hadith. Lakin, as for Al-Imam Abi Dawood and Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, both of them are what? As Ibn Taymiyyah said, they are imamani fil fiqh min ahli al-ijtihad. So that's why we chose this book. Sahih? Sunan Abi Dawood has this distinct characteristics in it. The scholars, they praised Al-Imam Abi Dawood. And we're going to now go into the Thana'ul Ulama'i, the praise that the scholars have put to Al-Imam Abi Dawood. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, these are the praises that were said about him. Muhammad ibn Ishaq al-Saghani and Ibrahim al-Harbi, when they came across the Sunan Abi Dawood, written by Al-Imam Abi Dawood, and they saw the book, and they looked at it, they were amazed with what he wrote. And they were amazed at how he structured it. And the words that he picked, and the way that he chaptered his book, they were shocked and amazed with it. And they said the following statement about him. They said, أُلِينَ لِأَبِي دَاوُودَ الْحَدِيثِ. Allah has made hadith soft for Abi Dawood, كَمَا أُلِينَ لِدَاوُودَ الْحَدِيدِ. The way Allah made the metal soft for Dawood alayhi salam. Did Allah not say in the Quran, وَأَلَنَّا لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ. Nabi Allah Dawood, we made وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَا دَاوُودَ مِنَّا فَضْلًا يَا جِبَالُ أَوِّي بِمَعَهُ وَالطَّيْرَ وَأَلَنَّا لَهُ الْحَدِيدِ. We made the metal soft for who? Nabi Allah Dawood would just grab the metal. And that's how Al-Imam Abi Nabi Allah Dawood, what was his job? He used to make the armor. How would he make the armor? Because he could bend things. He didn't need a machine or burning the metal. The same way Allah made the metal soft for Nabiullah Dawood, he made hadith soft for Abu Dawood. That's the statement of who? Muhammad ibn Ishaq al-Saghani and al-Imam al-Harbi rahimahullah. Muhammad ibn Ishaq al-Saghani, he died the year 270. And Ibrahim al-Harbi, he died the year 281 Hijriya. So they praised him. Also, his own student, Allan ibn Abdul Samad, he said, كان أبو داود من فرسان هذا الشأن. And Imam Abi Dawood was the Fursan. Fursan means forefront riders of this particular field. Musa ibn Harun al-Hafidh, who died in 294, he said, خلق أبو داود في الدنيا للحديث. Abi Dawood was created in this world, and Allah brought the Abu Dawood in this world for hadith. وفي الآخرة للجنة. And hereafter Allah made him to place him in Jannah, inshaAllah. مَا رَأَيْتُ أَفْضَلَ مِنْهُ. I never saw anyone greater than him. And I never saw anyone more virtuous than him. Abu Bakr al-Khalal, the great faqih al-ma'ruf that's well known, he said Abu Dawood, Sulaiman ibn al-Ash'ath, al-Sijistani, al-Imam al-Muqaddam fi zamanihi, رجل لم يسبقه إلى معرفة بتخريج العلوم وبصره بمواضعها أحد في زمانه رجل ورع مقدم. He said Abu Dawood, Sulaiman ibn al-Ash'ath al-Sijistani, he's a forefront in this field. No one preceded him in knowing how to extract knowledge from this deen. His insight and how he saw things, rahimahullah, he was alone in this, in that at his time. رَجُلٌ وَرِعٌ. He was a man who had these characteristics of wara. Wara is when a person leaves off what is doubtful and goes towards what is clear-cut permissible. Many other scholars praised him. Ibn Hibban, rahimahullah, he said about him, أبو داود أحد أئمة الدنيا فقها وعلما وحفظا ونسكا وورعا وإتقانا ممن جمع وصنف وذب عن السنن وقمع من خالفها وانتحل ضدها. He said Abu Dawood is from the أئمة الدنيا فقها. In fiqh, he's the imam of the dunya. علم and حفظ, and he's carrying, the way he carried himself and his piety and how he was precise. He said ممن جمع وصنف. He gathered and he authored. وذب عن السنن. He defended the sunnah from all of the weak narrations that were trying to be, that were being tried to be attributed to our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وقمع من خالفها وانتحل ضدها. He destroyed those who opposed the sunnah and he clarified their path. Al-Hakim al-Naysaburi, I'm going to conclude with him. He said كان أبو داود إمام أهل الحديث في عصري بلا مدافعة. Al-Imam Abi Dawood, he's the Imam of the people of Hadith at his time, bila mudafa'ah, without any argument. So there's no dispute about it, that he was the Imam of his time. And there's also other kalam that an Imam al-Nawawi said about him. Shaykh al-Islam ibn, let me read the kalam of these four scholars. It's important I mentioned it. An Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah, he said, وَاتَّفَقَ الْعُلَمَاءِ عَلَى الثَّنَاءِ عَلَى أَبِي دَاوُودِ. He said that the scholars are unanimously agreed upon in the praise of Abi Dawood. وَوَصْفِهِ بِالْحِفْظِ التَّامِ. And they all attributed to him the characteristics of being a hafiz. وَالْعِلْمِ الْوَافِرِ وَالْإِتْقَانِ وَالْوَرَعِ وَالْدِينِ وَالْفِقْهِ الثَّاقِبِ فِي الْحَدِيثِ وَفِي غَيْرِهِ. That he had itqan, he precise, he had wara, he had religion, he had fiqh, which understanding which was precise in hadith and in other than it. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said about him, Al-Bukhari wa Abu Dawood, Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Abu Dawood, afqahu ahli al-sahihi wa sunan. They are the most greatest in fiqh, Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Abu Dawood, from all of the other six. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah, he said, Al-Imam, Shaykh al-Sunnah, Muqaddam al-Huffaz. And he also said about him, Thabtun Hujjah, Imamun Amil. These were the terms that he gave to him. He called him Shaykh al-Sunnah, Imam, Muqaddam al-Huffaz, the forefront of the Huffaz. He called him Thiqa. His integrity is on point. Hujjah, he's a proof. Imam, he's a leader, someone to be followed. And he's Amil, a person who implements his knowledge. The last person is Hafidh ibn Kathir, rahimahullah. He said, أحد أئمة الحديث الرحالين الجوالين في الآفاق والأقاليم. He said he was one of the scholars of hadith who traveled and Al-Rahal is a person who travels a lot. Al-Jawwal is a person who also goes around the world. جمع وصنف وخرج وألف وسمع الكثير عن مشايخ البلدان في الشام ومصر والجزيرة والعراق وخراسان وغير ذلك وله السنن المشهورة المتداولة بين العلماء. He authored, he brought books out. He heard many ahadith from scholars in Egypt, in Sham, in Jazeera, Iraq, Khurasan, and other than that. He traveled to all of those places and he heard from the scholars of those places. Walahu, and for him is As-Sunanul Mashhura. He has the famous Sunan that we know, that he has rahimahullah al-mutadawalatu bayna al-ulama, that the scholars, they pass on to each other. Inshallah ta'ala, next week, Saturday, bi-idhnillah al-kareem, we will finish the Sunani al-Imam Abi Dawood al-Sijistani. We want to speak about the Sunan. We haven't spoken about the book yet. All of this was about the author. Next Saturday, inshallah ta'ala, where we have the class, we're going to speak about the Sunan al-Imam Abi Dawood, the Sunnah, Sunan, that he authored. And the way that we plan to speak about it is in two ways. First of all, we're going to define the book, At-Ta'rifu bi-Sunan al-Imam Abi Dawood. What was the name for the book? And who are the narrators who narrated the book? We're going to also speak about how he categorized the book, how many chapters are in the book, and how many ahadiths. And then the second chapter will be, inshallah ta'ala, Manhaj al-Imam Abi Dawood fi Sunani, the methodology he took in authoring this book. Once we finish this, inshallah ta'ala, on Sunday we will start the Kitab bi-idhnillahi al-Kareem, Kitab al-Siyam. We will do it. And this, inshallah, brothers, is very important that you have a good understanding of the book and the author. So when you hear Rawahu Abu Dawood, it has a waqa. It has an effect in your heart. And you understand the weight of this book. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.